Hi there, welcome to Scrap and Coffee. I'm going to continue with the box and folio project. So we already made the box in the previous video and I've decorated it and I've chosen the Remember the Magic paper by Paper Phenomenon. And I will do a complete project share when everything is done, but here you can see a little bit how I've decorated it. And today we are going to start with making the folio that will go in the box. And I've made a little tryout, so I will show you quickly how it will look. I'm going to use the same closure that I used for the box, and the folio will measure 8 inches by 10 inches with a 3/4 inch spine. And today we will be working on the base and the middle part of the folio, and the folio will be made in 3 sections. And the middle section is what we are going to start with today. So I'm going to show you quickly how this folio will look. However, I did some changes in it. So here I'm showing you that you can use photo mats as a closure for the middle part. And there will be a waterfall that has different photo size options with a different closure as well as like a slide and lock. And we have a pouched pocket on the other side, and in there we will put a booklet or maybe some photo mats. It's depending on how many space we have left to put something in there, so it's not too bulky. Large photo area in the middle. And here I've increased that gusset a little bit there. So then there is a flap with a pocket and another flap to go on top of that. Then on the left side of the folio again, I have a flap and then 2 side pockets, and you can use that as a closure with a photo mat again. Some stack pockets in the middle, and I don't think I will be using that closure that I'm showing you here. And then again, photo mat, so there is a lot of options to place photos on there. And then you can place a photo mat in the side pocket to keep that flap closed, or you can use magnets, or however you like. And then on the right we have smaller sections, again with a lot of flaps and photo opportunity. And you can close this however you like. Still have to think about a closure for it. And again, photo opportunity and a stack pocket over there. So I did do a couple of changes in it, but this is what it will be looking like at the end. And then we can close it and probably use a magnet. So we are going to start with making the base, and for that we are going to need 4 pieces of cardstock. And I've cut them all to size, and I still need to do the scoring and the placing the tape on it. So first we have piece A that measures 8 by 10 inches and it doesn't need any scoring. Then we have piece B that measures 8 3/4 by 10 inches. And we are going to score this with 8 3/4 inch side on top. And we are going to score at 1/2 inch. And at 1 1/4 inch. So that will make a gusset of 3/4 inch. And there will be a cutting guide for this available on my website once the whole project is done. Then we have piece C that measures 6 inches by 10 inches, and with the 6 inch side on top we are going to score at 1/2 inch and at 1 inch. So 1/2 inch and 1 inch. And the last piece for the base is piece D that measures 10 inches by 4.5 inches. And with the 4.5 inch on top, we are going to score again at 1/2 inch. And we are going to score at 3/4 inch. And that's the scoring for these pieces. So now we are going to place some double-sided tape. And for piece B, we are going to do that on the bumpy side of the piece, between the cut edge and the 1/2 inch score line. I'm using 3/8 inch tape here. You can use 1/4 inch tape, or you can use wet glue, whatever you like to use to construct your albums. So also for piece C, we are going to apply the tape on the bumpy side between the cut edge and the first half inch score line. And then for piece D, we are going to apply our tape on the dented side between the cut edge and the half inch score line. So for pieces B and C on the bumpy side, and for piece D on the dented side. So I'm going to give all of that a quick burnish, so it's a little bit easier to remove the tape backing, and then I'm going to taper that half inch. So I'm going to start cutting at the half inch score line up to the cut edge at a slight angle, and I'm doing that for all three pieces that we've placed tape on. Then we are going to place piece D to the side for a second. We are going to place our piece A on the middle of our work surface, and we will lay our piece B on the left side of piece A and piece C on the right side of piece A with tape facing upwards. And I'm going to fold on that first score line just a little bit. I'm not going to burnish it or anything, but it's just so that the score line is a little bit better visible for me, so I can see what I'm doing. And I'm removing the tape backing partially from piece B, and I'm going to place piece A on top of piece B on that half inch, so that I'm still able to see that half inch score line, and try to line up the top and bottom edge. And then when I have it where I want it, I'm going to press on the place where the tape backing is removed, then keep all of it in place and carefully remove the rest of the tape backing. And then we are going to give that a quick burnish. And we are going to do the same thing for piece C, only on the other side of piece A. So again, I'm just folding slightly on that score line so I can see it a little bit better. And first I wanted to do it on my right side, but it was easier for me to do it on the other side. So I'm going to turn it around. So just go with however works for you. And just take your time on this. You wanted to have it nicely lined up, but you know, it's not the end of the world if it's a little crooked, but yeah, just take your time, but don't be too hard on yourself. So again, I'm just pushing on where the tape backing is removed, and then while keeping it in place, I'm carefully removing the rest. And now I'm going to fold on all of the score lines and burnish them. So we're just going to fold over, and if you placed piece A where you were still able to see your score line, the folding should be pretty easy. And we're also going to fold on the second score line so our gusset will stand up. So on that side, now we have 3/4 of an inch gusset. So we are going to do the same thing for the piece C, just fold on that score line. And here I was a little close to the score line, so I had to work it a little bit more, but it was still going very well. So, and again, I'm going to burnish on the second score line, and then we will have half inch gusset on that side for now. And then the last thing we need to do is place our D piece on there, and that will be our closure. So I'm going to fold on the second score line on PC and lay it flat, because that's where I want to attach the D piece. And here I'm folding and burnishing, but I almost forgot that we need to make the cuts for the closure. So I'm folding on both score lines, but when you place it, you want to have it fold on the first score line only. So you will be able to see the score line, the second score line, when you place it. So we need to make the cuts to get that angle on there for that closure. And for it, I'm going to Place the dented side of the piece up, and I'm going to make a pencil mark at 6¾ inches from the left side of the piece. Now, if you want to have the pointy part of this piece on the other side, then you're going to do it from the right side of the piece. So you just make that measurement, measure it from the other side. Here we are going 1 inch from the second score line. Make a pencil mark, and we do the same thing on the other side. So 1 inch from the second score line. And then we are going to cut from pencil mark to pencil mark. So I'm just lining up the pencil marks on my cutting surface or on my paper trimmer. And with this one, it's pretty easy to do. You can also just connect the pencil tick marks with your pencil first before you cut. So that will be our closure. So no reinforcements on this one like we did on the box. So now I'm going to fold on the first score, 1/2 inch score line, and place that on top of that piece C. So I'm just again just removing that tape backing parsley. And I'm just going to work on the bottom because that's the easiest way to go for me. But still, I was a little bit struggling with this piece. I don't know why, but I think I stuck it down just before I wanted it, but I was able to fix that. So again, now I have it where I want it. I'm holding it in place and just remove the rest of the tape backing. Don't push on it too hard because then you will rip the tape backing. And then give that a burnish, and then the base for our folio is done. And we can start working on the middle part. I just felt that was easiest with a waterfall to do first, so you don't have any bulk to work on. Just reinforcing that second score line here so that gusset will be standing up. And this one piece has a 1/4 inch gusset, so on top of that 1/2 inch gusset, this side is also 3/4 inch high. So for the middle part, I've also cut all my pieces, but haven't scored anything yet, so I'm just going to do it in parts. We are going to start with making the waterfall, and for that we have our piece E, and piece E measures 10 inches. By 5 1/8 inches, so 5 1/8 inches, and I'm going to score that at 1/2 inch, and then we are going to give this 3/8 gusset, so I'm going to score at 7/8 inch. So this piece is scored at 1/2 inch and at 7/8 inch. And then we have all our waterfall pieces. We are going to start with pieces F, 2 pieces. That measures 3¾ by 4¼. And with the 3¾ on top, we are going to score at 1/2 inch. Both pieces. And I've got these pieces just a hair under 4¼. And I will explain later why I did that. Then we have 2 pieces of G. That measures 4¾ by 4¼. And with the 4¾ inch side on top, we scored at 1/2 inch. And again, these 2 pieces, I got just a hair under the 4¼. And last are 2 pieces of H that measure 6¾ by 4¼. And with the 6¾ inch side on top, we are going to score at 1/2 inch. And also these pieces, I've got just a hair under that 4¼. Then we also have that slide and lock closure. And for that I have pieces I, G and K. And piece I measures 1¼ by 4¼. And I've scored this with the 4¼ in top at 1/2 inch. And piece J is 8½ by 1¼. And I've scored it at 1/2 inch with the 8½ on top. Now piece K, I'm going to do that when I have my pattern paper on the closure, because the thickness of the closure is going to determine how I want to use my piece K. I wasn't sure yet at this point, so I'm going to leave that for now, and I will show you in a later video what I've done with it. So now we are going to place our double-sided tape or your wet glue, whatever you like to use, and I'm going to place it for all pieces on the dented side between the cut edge and the first half inch score line for piece E, and on the other pieces between the cut edge and the score line. So all pieces on the dented side. For piece J, I'm going to place the tape on the bumpy side. And for piece I, you can place it on the dented side as well. So only piece G, I place it on the bumpy side. So after I've given everything a quick burnish, then I'm going to taper piece E between the half inch, from the half inch to the cut edge, because we are placing these pieces over the whole length of the folio, so you want to hide that construction a little bit. And then I'm going to fold on those score lines. And I've used a heavier weight cardstock for this folio, so folding on the score lines was a little bit more difficult sometimes. And then we can place our piece E in our folio. So this will go in the middle part of the folio. So I'm opening it up. Piece B is on the left side of piece A, and piece C is on the right side. And I'm going to place this piece E, and you just want to fold on your first score line, so you will see the second score line when you place it, on the edge of piece A, up against that first score line of piece B. So you still want to see that score line. That's, you're going to hear me say that a lot, but that's important when we place pieces, that we are still able to see the score line. So I'm just lining up the bottom and the top edge, bumping it up against that score line on the edge of piece A. So when we've done that, we are going to open piece E up. And here I just fold on that second score line, because I really want to be able to see it. Because when we are going to place our waterfall pieces, it's very important that our pieces are going to fit. I'm going to line them up with the cut edge that's now on the bottom, so actually on the left side of piece E. And we still want to see that score line. It's very important. So I'm going to start with the smallest pieces, pieces F. And we are going to, those are the first pieces of the waterfall. So we are going to place those on top. And what I want is to line it up with that cut edge, and place it in between that score line. And that's why I've got all these pieces just a hair under that 4 1/4. So I was sure that it was going to fit in between it. Because if you go over your score line, the piece will not fold of close properly. So that's very important. If you don't see your score line, then you have to cut your piece a little shorter. So I'm really going on that cut edge of piece E here. That's my guidance for the whole waterfall. And you could place a piece of white paper underneath piece E, so you really are able to see that cut edge of that piece. So for the second piece, again, I'm just going on that cut edge. I had a little tape overhang there. So for every piece, I just keep checking myself. Do I still see that score line when I place this piece down? And am I straight? So after we place the two pieces F, we are going to place the two pieces of G. And after that, the two pieces of H. So I'm just going to repeat what I did with the other pieces. Going for that cut edge. And just do that for all the pieces. I'm not going to show you all placing all the pieces on there because I think we've got the point. So this is my last piece of the waterfall. These are the longer pieces and the hardest to get on. They're straight. But I just went for that cut edge and that worked for me really well to get it on there straight. So and then it's all on there. So you can see that the spacing in between the pieces is not the same for every piece, and if you don't like that, then of course you can just use one size of these flaps for your waterfall. But I thought it was a little bit different for once. So I'm just burnishing all my folds one more time. It's just what I do. And now we are going to place that closure. So I'm going to place the longer piece, piece J, on the bottom. And I will place that on the back of piece E, like how we look at it right now. So it's actually the front of piece E, but... And I'm trying to center it in the middle. And I wanted to do the same thing for piece I, but it was just too thick to place it underneath on piece E. So I'm just going to place that on top of that first flap. So here I removed the tape backing and I'm just going to use my ruler to determine my spacing. It was about 1 inch and 3/8 of an inch that I needed to make it centered. And then I was struggling a little bit with this, but then I'm just placing it as straight as I can, making sure that I was able to see that score line so I could fold it over. And then just place that piece E on top of there. Just give that a quick burnish and then I'm going to turn the folio around, upside down, so I can place my eyepiece, lining it up with piece G. You want to have that on there as straight as you can. And that's pretty difficult to do. So I'm going to place it on top of the first flap. I just thought it was best. And I did it with the other one underneath because I think it gives us a tighter closure than when we place both pieces on top of the waterfall. And if you don't like this closure, of course you can just use any other closure that you like. A magnet or a ribbon. Yeah, think of something. So I'm really trying to line up pieces G and I here. And then place it on the top edge. From this point of view, it's the bottom edge. And then for now, I'm just going to use a paper clip to keep it closed because, like I said before, I'm going to use piece K to wrap around so that we can use it as a slide and lock. But I'm going to do that when the pattern paper is on there. So I'm trying to keep my piece K somewhere where I won't lose it. And then the next thing we are going to do is make the pouched pocket that will go on the other side of this middle part. And for that pouched pocket, we are going to need our pieces L and M. And they need some scoring, so we are going to start with our piece L, and piece L measures 10 inches by 3 3/4 of an inch. And with the 3 3/4 of an inch on top, we are going to score at 1/2 inch. And for our piece M, this piece measures 11 inches. And on the 11 inch side on top, we are going to score at 1/2 inch on both sides. So that's 1/2 inch and 10.5 inches. And it's 11 by 3 5/8 inch. And with the 3 5/8 inch on top, we are going to score at 1/2 inch. So this will be a pocket. And for these pieces, we are going to place our tape on the dented side in between the cut edge and the score line. So for piece L, that's on one side, and for piece M, it's on all three sides. And then again, just give that a burnish. I just like to do that. For piece L, I'm going to taper that 1/2 inch flap because it's going over the whole length of the folio again. And for piece M, we are going to miter the corners to reduce the bulk. So we are just going to cut across where the score lines meet up. And then we can fold on all that score lines. So we are, I'm going to lay it flat for now because it's a little bit easier to show you how to place the pocket on top of that flap. So it's important with the pockets to make sure that we don't have any overlapping of our 1/2 inch flaps in the corners. So I'm just checking that real quick and I'm good. If you have a little overlapping, then you just recut it a little bit more. So we are going to place the pocket on top of the flap and we are going to line up the cut edges from both flap and pocket, and that will give you about 1/8 inch spacing between the bottom of your pocket and the score line of piece L, and that's what we want. So I'm just removing all my tape backing here, but I think I might want to recommend you to do it in parts. Just remove one part first before you remove the rest, because it's quite difficult to place this pocket on top of that flap and have it all nicely lined up when you remove all your tape backing. So I just decided to go from one smaller edge and then bring it to the other side. Try to get that cut edge as nicely lined up as I could. So I forgot that we first have to place our piece N in the folio before we can place the pocket. So we have piece N here that measures 7, and I just went through it, 7 1/4 by 8 3/8. And I'm going to score on a 7 1/4 inch side at 1/2 inch and on 7/8 inch. And then we are also going to score our other two flaps because we have a scoreboard out. Here I just went a little bit wrong with the scoring and I'm adjusting it by going over with my bone folder. So we also have piece O, and piece O is going to measure 7 3/8 inch by 3 3/4 inch. And on a 7 3/8 inch side, we are going to score at 1/2 inch on both sides. So that's 1/2 inch and 6 7/8 inch. And on the 3 3/4 inch sides, we are going to score at 1/2 inch. Then our piece P is 6 3/4 by 4 1/4. And on the 6 3/4 inch side, we are going to score at 1/2 inch. So I'm just going to repeat piece O quickly. It measures 7 3/8 by 3 3/4. And on the 7 3/8 inside, you're going to score at 1/2 inch and 6 7/8 inch. And on the 3 3/4 inside at 1/2 inch. Then for all these flaps and pockets, we are going to place our tape on the dented side between the cut edge and the score lines. So I wanted to taper this half inch flap, but you don't need to. So now I'm just folding all my score lines. Both of them. And again, this piece will have a 3/8 of an inch gusset, because it will lay on top of our waterfall that also has a 3/8 of an inch gusset. And then we can place this piece in the folio, but I do recommend you to place the pocket, piece O, on top of piece N before you place it in the folio. But I didn't do it, but I will recommend you to do that. So I'm going to place it on the right side of piece A, bumping it up against the score line, first score line of piece C. And then I'm going to center it from top to bottom, and that you will need about 3/4 of an inch from the bottom, and then it's centered. So first place your end piece before you place your pouched pocket. Then we are going to open piece N up, just increasing that gusset here. And then we can place our pocket up against the score line of piece N. So we want to be able to see that first score line of piece N and lining it up with your top and bottom of piece A. And I've already removed all the tape backing of this piece, so it was a little bit harder for me. So this piece will intend to stand up a little bit, and that's what you get with the shorter pieces. But when our booklet or our photo mats are in there, it will nicely lay flat. So for our O piece, we are going to miter the corners, because this will be the pocket that will go on top of piece N. And like I said, I'm placing it on top of piece N right now, but I would place it on there before you would place it in the folio. It's easier. Just make sure that there is no overlapping in the corners on the half inch flaps. And then I have a piece of white here so I can see the edges of our end piece. And I'm going to line up the left bottom corner with the left bottom corner of, well, the left bottom corners of both piece N and the O piece. And then it should fit exactly on your piece N, not going over the score line on your left. If you do go over, I suggest you re-score your piece a little bit, about 1/8 of an inch inwards. So your pocket gets a little shorter. But the measurement should provide for it to fit on there exactly. So that's the pocket on top of piece N, and then our piece P is a flap. That will go on top of piece E. And I am going to center it with the top of piece N and the pocket on piece N. And for that, again, I'm placing just a piece of white paper so I can see it. I'm lining it up with the top of piece N, placing it in the pocket. And I think it was about 3/8 of an inch on top and bottom, but I eyeballed it a little bit. So here, when you place it, you don't want to push too hard on your E piece. So make sure your gusset is standing up, and then just carefully line it up with that edge of piece E. If you push on it too hard, you will push everything down and make it flat. So be careful with that. Try to get that edge nicely lined up. So like I showed in the beginning, you can use a photo mat in the pocket that lays on top of the P-piece to keep it closed. But of course, you can also use a magnet or a swing tab to keep that middle section all closed. So that's the construction for now. In the next video, we will complete it. I hope you are enjoying the folio so far. And I want to thank you for watching and hope to see you in the next video. Enjoy the rest of your day.